We acknowledge that we gather for worship on the traditional territories of the Anishinaabe First Nations. This territory is covered by the Upper Canada Treaties and is within the lands protected by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Agreement. We live this by honoring and respecting the four directions: land, waters, plants, animals, and ancestors that walked before us, their history, spirituality, and culture. We acknowledge the land on which we gather is part of the treaty lands and territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit.
Hello, I extend a warm welcome to each one of you for joining us at Grace United Church in Burlington on our YouTube channel. We hope you're able to join us each week for our services, and we also encourage you to watch news you can use on this same channel for news about our church activities. We remind you that although the building is still closed, Grace is here to support you and your family. We encourage you to reach out to the church if you are in need. We know that we have people participating in this service from many locations, and we encourage you to post in the comments section or to email us to let us know what city you're watching from. And now, as we worship together, may you be uplifted and comforted by the Word of God.
We would like to welcome Caitlin MacKenzie as our guest leader this Sunday. Caitlin is a candidate for ordination in the United Church and a Master's Divinity student at the Atlantic School of Theology. She is passionate about justice, kindness, and community. She's a preacher's kid who has been blessed to offer worship leadership across many small communities in Southern Ontario over the last 10 years. Kate is a mother of two, a teen daughter, Sophia, and a preteen son, Henry. And they live in Brantford with her partner, her mother-in-law, a very happy dog, and a very lovely cat. Thank you for joining us, Caitlin.
Let us kindle the light of our Christ candle. We're blessed to be in the presence of Christ's Spirit. Good morning. My name's Caitlin MacKenzie, and it's an honor to be here with you. Thank you so much for inviting me to share in your service this week. I'm speaking to you today from my home in Brantford, Ontario, which is on the Haldimand Track, the traditional territory of the Attawandaron, Anishinaabe, and Haudenosaunee people, and is on the edge of the territory governed by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum. I'm glad to be joining you wherever you are today. And as we open this time of worship, I invite you to pause for a moment and set aside the things that may be distracting you as we prepare for this time of worship. And allow me to open this time together with our call to worship. Hungering and thirsting, we come to the living bread. Feed us with your love and healing power, O Lord. Give us the bread of hope and the compassion that we may also feed others. Praise be to you, O Lord, for your compassion for us. Praise be to you, O Lord, for your steadfast love. Please join us in singing from More Voices, number 79, Spirit, Open Our Hearts.
Spirit, open my heart to the joy. God, who heals and transforms, we hunger and thirst for you. We bring our sadness to exchange for the bread of joy. We offer our despair to exchange for the bread of hope. We lay down our weariness to exchange for the bread of inspiration. Join with us today while we ask for the bread that sustains, so as we travel together, we might find ourselves in community even while we are apart. We ask these things in Jesus' name and continue in the words he taught, singing,
won't be much longer now until the kids are headed back to school, and many of us will go back out into the world where we will meet new people and see some people we haven't seen in a long time. I know I'm excited about this, but I'm also a little nervous. It's great to be around other people, but it can be hard too. Sometimes we meet people who are unpleasant, unkind, cranky, short-tempered. And sometimes unhappy people may say or do something that hurts our feelings or makes us angry. Our first reaction might be to respond to them in the same way, with anger. You might feel like saying unpleasant things back to them. But it's important for us to do our best to stop and think before we respond in those situations. There's a quote by a Scottish minister named Reverend Ian McLaren that's helped me to remember this. He says, "Be kind, for everyone you meet is fighting a hard battle." I'm sure you've heard that before. Be kind, because everyone you meet is fighting a hard battle. We don't know what hardships and troubles others have. We don't know of their illnesses, their hurts, their problems. Maybe they've been mistreated by someone. Perhaps someone they care about is hurting and they don't know what to do about it. Bad feelings make people act in ways that are unkind sometimes. And while that isn't really fair, it's important for us to try and be understanding and to respond with kindness. Today, one of the stories we'll hear in the Bible tells us to be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. We all make mistakes. We've all done things we wish we hadn't. We've all acted in ways that were less than pleasant, but God loves us and forgives us for the mistakes we make. We can use that same love to be kind and to forgive others. So, when we get back to our routines and find that people are crummy sometimes, Just remember that on your crummy days, God loves you. And instead of being crummy back, remember that others may be fighting a hard battle. Instead of responding with unkindness, take a second and choose to be kind and try and forgive them. Maybe you could ask what's making them feel so angry, and instead of adding to their hurt, help them to feel better. I always like to end these moments in a repeat after me prayer. So I'll say a line and invite you to repeat it. Let's pray together. Loving God, we are sorry that sometimes we say things that are unkind. Help us to remember that you always forgive us. Help us to forgive others and think about why they might be hurting. Remind us of your love and help us to share it wherever we go. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And I invite you again to join me in singing, this time from Voices United, number 460, All Who Hunger.
For the new life. The Bible doesn't tell us not to feel angry. This New Testament reading points out how important it is to handle our anger properly. If vented thoughtlessly, our anger and resentments can hurt others and destroy relationships. If left to bottle up and fester, our anger will cause us to become bitter and destroy us from within. Dealing maturely with anger and fear can be the hardest parts of any relationship. We need to follow God's examples in His Son Jesus, as Jesus lived a life of love and forgiveness. Reading Paul's epistle to Ephesians chapter 4, verses 25 through to chapter 5, verse 2. So then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor and work honestly with their own hands so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God.
This morning's second scripture reading is from John's Gospel. It follows up the miracle of sharing out the loaves and fishes, and Jesus tells them their bread came from God, that God's bread is more sustaining than just an ordinary meal. Jesus refers to the Old Testament story of how Moses fed manna to the Israelites. The religious leaders refused to believe that Jesus was God's divine son, and they could not tolerate his message. Many people reject Christ because they say they cannot believe he is the Son of God. To shield themselves from the message, they reject the messenger. John chapter 6, verse 35, and verses 41 to 51. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Then the Jews began to complain about him because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." They were saying, "Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Jesus answered them, "Do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me, and I will raise that person up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, 'And they shall all be taught by God.' Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh."
Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for the gift of your word. And as we think on these things and ponder your message to us, open our hearts and minds to hear you. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I have just finished 6 tough weeks of online classes. And so to celebrate, my daughter and I packed up a picnic for our family. We made a pitcher of lemonade, some sandwiches and salads, and we headed for the park. We invited a good friend of ours to join us. We're all double vaxxed and we haven't seen each other in a long time. And so I was so excited to break bread with him again. But in the excitement, I completely forgot that he has celiac disease. And so he couldn't have any of the lovely sandwiches we made, forget breaking bread. He was happy to nosh on some watermelon and cut veggies and a handful of tortilla chips, but I felt awful. Bread is such a staple in our house. I just didn't think of it. Sandwiches and scones and buns and loaves, you name it, we love it. We like fry bread and bannock and pita, tortilla, bao, naan, and roti. There is something so comforting about those carbs. They seem to fill us up both belly and soul, especially a slice of toast made with homemade bread and slathered with butter. That is a gift of God. Bread of some sort or another has long been a staple in cultures around the world, including in the ancient Near East where our scriptures were written. So it makes sense that bread is included a lot. I didn't count it myself, but according to Google, bread or words with the same meaning like cake or loaf is mentioned at least 492 times in the Bible from Genesis right through to Revelation. Some examples are Abraham's bread for the 3 visiting angels, the bread that Jacob broke with Laban, the unleavened bread of the Exodus, the manna from heaven, the bread of the presence, the 12 loaves of showbread in the temple, the loaves and fishes, the broken bread of the Last Supper, the bread that greeted the travelers at the end of the Emmaus Road. Jesus taught us to give thanks this day for our daily bread. And even the word Bethlehem means house of bread. Bread has lots of different connotations in the Bible. It can be a symbol of presence, provision, hospitality, sacrifice, or covenant. Today in our scripture, we heard Jesus say, "I am the bread of life, come down from heaven." Well, those of us who grew up in the church have heard that statement many times over, especially during communion. I did sneak a peek at your communion service last week, and I heard Reverend Helen use it during the words of institution. So it may seem strange that such a familiar phrase for us was something that was disquieting among those who were listening to Jesus preach, and it was worthy of a bit of a commotion. In John's gospel, we hear a bit of that commotion. Jesus' statement sparks a controversy among the listeners who challenge him on it. Who does this guy think he is? Isn't he just Joseph's son? What does he mean, bread from heaven? This murmuring among the people echoes the grumbling in the wilderness among the exiles from Egypt, who God provisioned with manna from heaven. Here again, God is provisioning the people with what they need, basic sustenance. Only in this case, it goes far beyond feeding just their physical needs and addresses instead their spiritual needs. We're just a few verses after Jesus literally feeding people with literal bread, but here we find him feeding them in a different way, a way that is more lasting and unhindered by dietary restrictions. The bread of life is not composed of wheat and yeast and salt and water, but a spiritual bread that nourishes in a different way. I told you that in the Bible, alongside the regular bread that feeds bodies, bread is used as a symbol for presence, provision, hospitality, covenant, and sacrifice. Here's what I mean. The showbread in the temple demonstrated God's presence and abundance. The manna in the wilderness demonstrated God's provision and protection. The loaves that Abraham and Sarah offered to those 3 visiting angels demonstrated hospitality. Jacob and Laban broke bread to institute peace and to seal a covenant between them. The bread and grains that were tithed to the temple demonstrated sacrifice, as did the bread that Jesus broke in the upper room. Taken all together, presence, provision, hospitality, covenant, and sacrifice, we find the core teachings of Jesus. He was God incarnate, presence. He is the way, the truth, and the light, the living bread, provision. He welcomed the stranger and shared meals with the most marginalized, hospitality. He instituted a new covenant. And his life ended in sacrifice when he was killed by the state in an effort to silence his message of justice and peace. Jesus' teaching is the bread that continues to nourish us thousands of years after he first walked among us. This teaching was evident in the first few generations of people who came after him and carried that living bread forward. In his letter to the Ephesian church, Paul tries to convey some of these important messages to a community who really needed a fulfilling spiritual meal. In today's lesson, he speaks passionately about honesty and how to handle anger. Now, Paul doesn't say, never get angry. He accepts that anger is going to happen. After all, Jesus got angry. God has been known to get angry. And so if we're going to do our best to imitate the divine, as he suggests, anger is an occasional possibility. But leading from Jesus' teaching, that living bread, he cautions us not to allow our anger to cause us to sin. When we get angry, it can be tempting to lose sight of the larger picture, causing us to forget the intimate ways we are all connected. This turns us away from building each other up, and instead, we begin to tear each other down. This kind of anger is decidedly undivine. This is anger which is not useful and is destructive to the harmony that Jesus demonstrated. Paul cautions that speaking with anger makes room for the devil. Not words that I might choose, but then again, Paul and I don't agree on everything. But what we do agree on is that Jesus taught us to be kind to one another, tender-hearted, and forgiving of one another. These kind of lessons fill us up with good things and give us the spiritual calories that help us to keep working on a world that needs more kindness, more love, and more tenderness. It's hard to do the work of being a Christian on an empty tank, be it physically or spiritually empty. Empty tummies are probably the number one source of anger, and that's followed closely by empty hearts. And just as Jesus fed the people with physical bread first, and then let them know that he is the living bread, this is how we should serve others. Once physical needs are met, we can demonstrate how the teachings that sustain us, presence, provision, hospitality, covenant, and sacrifice, work in our lives. Minister and theologian Debbie Thomas from Palo Alto, California says, Jesus desires to sustain us in our lives, to be our journeying bread for every road trip, every perilous ride, every long haul, every rocky path. He desires to be our substance and our strength, not in some magical cure-all way, but in ways that meet us in our real lives, our real challenges, our real fears and griefs and hopes. Because Jesus knows better than anyone that the journey's hard. He knows it's too much for us to handle on our own. He knows that we need bread that sustains. We need him and we need each other. I like to think that a weekly worship is a time for us to pack our picnic baskets. And I hope that this time together has given you a chance to refill yours with the living bread that will carry you through this next week. May you bless those you meet with kindness and a good meal. Know that you are blessed and a blessing. Thanks be to God. Please, I invite you to join me in a prayer of gratitude. Let's pray. We thank you, Lord, for flour. Flour made from wheat or other grains, grown in the mystery of the earth, ripened in the warmth of the sun, ripened and then cut down at the harvest by a farmer's skill, ground by the miller, sold by the shopkeep, placed in a bowl. We thank you, Lord, for flour. We thank you, Lord, for salt. Jesus told us to be the salt of the earth, and we must never lose our flavor. And that salt, which adds flavor to our food, is also antiseptic to our wounds, reminding us of the challenge to our faith and the healing power of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for salt. We thank you, Lord, for yeast, that small yet living organism that enables the bread to rise, that reminds us of the fact that even small works done in Jesus' name can enable this kingdom to grow. We thank you, Lord, for yeast. We thank you, Lord, for water. Water without which none of us could live. Water which forms the other elements of our bread into dough, which having risen have been formed and drawn into shape by human hands and is baked to give us the staff of life. Water which cleanses and renews us, refreshes and revives us. The water of baptism which commits us to our faith. We thank you, Lord, for water, because we thank you, Lord, for bread. Bread, the basis of the food we eat, bread for toast, for sandwiches, for bread and jam, for bread pudding and buns, gluten-free bread, vegan bread, and bread made with chickpea flour, and bread that is broken and shared in communion with one another in remembrance. Remembrance of a night when Jesus sat with his friends at supper and broke the bread and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, broken for you." We thank you, God, for bread. Amen. Let us pray. Holy One, you are the bread of heaven, giving life to the world. You fill our emptiness with your goodness. You come to our weakness with your strength. Take and use these our gifts to bring in a rich harvest of your heavenly food and life-giving refreshment. Amen. Please join us as we sing again from Voices United, number 372, Though I May Speak.
Though I may speak with bravest fire and have the gift to all inspire and have not love, my words are vain as sounding brass and hopeless gain.
Though I may give all I possess striving soul, my love profess, but not begin my love within. The prophet soon turns strangely thin. Come, Spirit, come, our hearts control, our spirits all to be made whole.
Let us pray. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. This is the promise of God to whom we now pray." When I say, "Lord, in your mercy," please feel free to respond, "Hear our prayer." Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Creator, thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the bread of life for the world. Forgive us for elevating earthly appetites above devotion to you. Feed us with the knowledge of Christ so that we recognize our transgressions and gladly repent in his name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those whose daily needs for healthy food, clean water, and proper shelter goes unmet, and for those misusing what they have in the vain pursuit of pleasure. Feed them with the good things of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, Hear our prayer. Have mercy on those whose lives have been broken by violence and crime. Feed them with hope and new life. And bless our siblings in prison and those who minister to them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask that you feed those who are sick or sorrowing with healing and consolation. And today we pray particularly for Charlotte, Jim, Liz and Jordan, Rupaya, Lorna, Juan, Janet, Sylvia, Jean, Janice, Barb, Kathy, Joan, Ken, David, Philip, Chris, Dawn, Richard, and Jillian. And we ask that you meet the needs of others we know personally to be in want, and whom we now take a moment to name silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful parent, you heard the prayers of your people in the wilderness and fed them bread from heaven despite their grumbling. Graciously hear us today and feed us too with the bread of life from heaven, for he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our concluding hymn this morning is from Voices United Again, number 649, Walk With Me, I Will Walk With You. And now, as we extinguish the candle, may the fragrant smoke wafting up remind you to go out into the world, carrying what you've heard and what you've learned. Feed whomever you meet as Jesus fed you on the bread that lasts, and keep the flame lit in your heart until we meet again. And may the love of God, which gives life to the world, sustain you. May the bread of life, Jesus Christ, feed you with food that endures to eternal life. And may the power of the Holy Spirit nourish and strengthen you in faith. Go in peace to love and serve. Amen.
Believe, reach out to us.